to begin by inviting the audience to stand for our invitation. I would also like to let the audience know that the seating behind the faculty is now available. So for those who are in the back, I would invite you to come down and put in the rows and enjoy the ceremony. As head of school, it's my pleasure to welcome you to the baccalaureate ceremony for the class of 2012. Tonight, we pause to celebrate the extraordinary accomplishments of this group of young people before we launch them officially at commencement tomorrow. At Baccalaureate, we have a tradition of inviting religious leaders from a variety of faiths in the Seacoast to take part in this gathering. This gesture is intended both to reflect the significance of the event as well as to acknowledge the diverse backgrounds of our graduating class. Tonight, it's my honor to introduce the Reverend Beth Hoffman, who serves as the pastor and teacher for the First Congregational United Church of Christ in Elliott, Maine. Her background suggests a remarkable blend of educational and spiritual training, and she has a deep experience in serving students, particularly those with special needs. These days, however, her life has taken on a higher calling, and she has shared her talents with many. She served as the director of spiritual care at Portsmouth Hospital, and she currently serves as the chaplain the Kittery Fire Department as well. She happens to have a connection with a number of Berwick Academy students, and it's hard to imagine a more ideal choice to provide the spiritual bookends to our gathering this evening. It's my pleasure to invite the Reverend Beth Hoffman to the podium at this time to lead us in our invocation.
Amen. big fan of commencements, baccalaureate holds special meaning. Perhaps it is because the roots of the ceremony extend back to Oxford University in 1432, when graduates had to deliver a speech in Latin before receiving their degree. There is something special about being connected to such a tradition, and although you won't hear much Latin tonight, it is an event rich in history. Before we begin, I do want to thank Rich Knowles and his building's crew for their attention to detail in setting up for tonight. The place looks fantastic. Colleen Meter, who has done a tremendous job coordinating the awards process from start to finish, and to our senior master of 38 years, Mr. Jim Sullivan, who has provided valuable insight and guidance about this ceremony. And I also truly want to thank my colleagues in these front rows. Your work in the classrooms, the athletic fields, the art studios, the countless other mediums has shaped this senior class. Your support, respect, and challenge has propelled this class to greater heights, and you have prepared them well for the challenges ahead. I know the students in front of you and the families behind you appreciate everything you have done. Thank you very much. And among this faculty, there are two that will always have special meaning for this class. Kyle Ridgway and Peter Lassie have been the advisors for the class of 2012, helping to shape their experience in the upper school. I'd like to invite both of them to stand, please, for a minute. During their journey together, there was a lot of laughter, a few tears, and a great deal of joy, especially tonight. I know how much this class has appreciated your dedication and your efforts to make their time special at Berwick. I'd like to thank you for your work, which is reflective not only of your commitment to this class, but of your own personal standards. Thank you very much. Finally, to the class of 2012. The people sitting next to you will always have a special place in your life. Hopefully, in the future, you will come back to your reunions, and you will live and relive those glory days. Do you remember Danny? Do you remember the girls' overtime win against Pinky and everybody else? Do you remember the boys' NetSack New England Championship? Those will be the kinds of things that you're saying, and I hope you relish each and every one of those moments. I also expect that you will continually reflect on how Berwick has served you. Over your time here at the Academy, we have done a lot of judging of you, and it's only fair that you do the same of us. We've written comments, determined awards, praised you, chided you, and laughed along with you. During your future years, you will have the chance to reflect and ask yourself the question, did this academy instill virtue and knowledge during your time here? Were we able to help you to make good decisions? Did we teach you to value yourself, your fellow classmates, and the larger world around you? Right now, you may have already formed some thoughts on this topic. However, it changes. It changes as you follow your passions, experience more successes, some failures, and you bring your own children into this world. I hope that when we see you in the future, it will become even clearer that your time here at the Academy has served you well. And as I've said many times over the course of this year, the class of 2012, this class, has done a remarkable job leading our upper school. Our successful year has its roots in your efforts. Not any single person, but the collective whole, the collective definition. And all of your work has brought us to this moment. 14 hours, 45 minutes away to commencement. Thank you for everything that you have done.
Thank you.
now my pleasure to introduce Moira McKinnon to recognize her cum laude of the inductees.
It's my honor to have this moment to recognize the outstanding work of some incredible students who have really raised the bar academically for Berwick and made us very proud of their achievements. So students, when I call your name, would you please stand and raise your name. Logan Clement, Catherine Davis, Mary DePascal, Elizabeth Duchesne, Nicole Kleinman, Elena Panatti, Haley Reddington, Abby Jean Scanlon, Caroline Seekins, Benjamin Siegel, Aaron Trainer, Nathan Winters, and Devin Wood.
This year's recipient of the Applied Music Award is Nicole Kleinman. Nicole has studied piano with Gail Haskell for the past 7 years, ever since she was in fifth grade. And Ms. Haskell is unable to be here today and asked me to read her presentation. Nicole is a wonderful student, and she really put the applied in applied music. Nicole possesses all those fabulous traits that promote success. She's tenacious, hardworking, intelligent, intuitive, meticulous, and passionate. Learning a musical instrument is a long-term process, and Nicole delights in the journey as well as the destination. She sees and hears the nuances in the music. She takes her skills and knowledge and applies them to a variety of genres, including classical, jazz, and pop. Nicole is open and accepting of everything, be it new music or new ideas. And she puts her own unique touch on each piece she plays. She delights in the intimacy of playing solo piano, then welcomes the conviviality of playing an ensemble with her friends. Setbacks move her forward, small victories are celebrated, and goals are reached. She gives the music a voice, and the music satisfies her soul. It's been my great pleasure working with Nicole all these years and watching her grow up into such a spectacular young lady. Congratulations to you, Nicole Kleinman, and may your hard work be filled with song.
He also had an unfailing work ethic to match his inquisitive nature, a perfect combination for success. His determination to strive for his personal best set a positive tone in the classroom, an unspoken standard which raised the bar for the entire class. All of his written work typically went above and beyond the expectations of the given assignment, but not in the hopes of a higher grade or any recognition, but because for him, that is the way it ought to be done. He is a serious student, though he never missed an opportunity to add a sense of humor to lighten a heavy topic. His natural Academic ability and tremendous hard work have allowed him to meet the high standards and expectations set forth in both the honors and AP classes. He's demonstrated a complete mastery of the material, earning the only A for the year in AP Biology. It's an honor for me to present the award for outstanding achievement in biology to Parker Lloyd.
Trademarks have ushered her towards wonderful success in her senior year, where she now commends her willingness to ask probing questions, to deal with the complexities of characters and authors' intentions, rather than boiling them down to a few simple ideas, and to navigate blog discussions in a way that mediates competing and at times even dissenting opinions. Earlier this fall, I was lucky enough to have Elizabeth in my Art of the Essay course, which met each morning in the library. I found her descriptions, critiques, and profiles to be among the most accomplished as she blended a natural flair for expression with an observant eye for the world around her. She wrote honestly and respectfully about overcoming her struggles in one particular class and presented a well-founded, lawyerly treatise on why dancers deserve to earn a sports credit at BA. Unsurprisingly, her skills in English are matched by those in calculus, biology, and chemistry, perhaps explaining why her essays are presented in such a logical way with such reasonable conclusions. The one critical evaluation of Elizabeth, if we can even call it that, which has trailed her since seventh grade, is her tendency to remain a bit quiet in her class. It must have then come as a great relief to her when she perused the course catalog and discovered a senior elective titled Unheard Voices, offered in winter term. Similar to my observations from the fall and to Mr. Sherbon's before mine, Mr. Kaspersak found himself searching for answers to her poignant questions and being left speechless after reading her blog postings. Clearly, Elizabeth has left her mark, silent though profound, on the minds of her teachers and classmates to populate English classrooms on this campus. In the fall, she will be off to UVA, an institution that certainly values its literary merit. It's not difficult at all to speculate that her achievements here will certainly follow her to Charlottesville. I thank Elizabeth for her efforts, and I wish her a promising 4 years at Virginia. So congratulations.
Good evening. I'm excited to present this award tonight because this student will be truly surprised, and that is not an indictment on her abilities, but it is a testament to her humility. In a language class, we look for a few specific things: energy, engagement, effort, and facility with the spoken word. A successful language student is willing to put oneself out there in front of his or her peers, arrive in class ready to engage in conversation even when the spirit does not move you. This person has done that for 4 years, taking her assignments and assessments seriously right up until the last class of her senior year. Over her high school career, the recipient has an A average in French, and she has been one of the hardest workers in the department. Remarkably, Madame Clinton pegged her as a viable candidate to live abroad for a summer only 1 year after she begun her French studies, which says as much about her personality as it does her achievement in the language. Understated and humble, this young woman is dependable both in and out of the classroom. She's an extremely talented athlete and leader. Ms. Ridgway said, and I quote, when she arrived at Berwick, she was asked to carry a tremendous amount of responsibility for female athletics. She has turned into an absolutely incredible leader, and her perseverance significantly affected girls' athletics at Berwick. She does all of this with an unassuming attitude and humility, shying away from the spotlight the same way she avoids a low grade. Getting to know her well was one of the true gifts of the school year for me. She will continue her academic and athletic exploits at Trinity College next year, and they will be lucky to have her. The Departmental Honor Award in French goes to Lindsay Bratton.
Up next is Latin. I can only
Tonight, it's my genuine pleasure to present the Latin Award to an exceptional young woman who has touched so many of our lives in so many ways here at the Academy. I've known Elizabeth Eddie Duchesne academically for 4 years, both as a student, an advisee, and as a friend. And during this time, I've seen quite an outstanding person and student develop. She has distinguished herself as a superb Latin student in my classes since the first year I taught her as a freshman, and recently completing her Berwick Latin career in my Latin 5 honors class. Over these 4 years, Elizabeth has received the national recognition for her achievement in the National Latin Exam, and as a sophomore, she was inducted into the National Latin Honors Society for her excellent achievement. I'm glad that Eddie decided to grade Latin. Her outstanding work ethic, perseverance, have helped her to go the distance and achieve this notoriety. There is no doubt that during these 4 years, she has shown the motivation, intense commitment, and the intellectual curiosity, and most importantly, the self-discipline needed in order to have done well in this closing language. Elizabeth, I applaud the woman you've become. You have risen and superseded all of my challenges over the years, and you have emerged in magnificence. You are a triumphant survivor. Finally, I know that you will make UVA as proud of you as Berwick has been. I will truly miss you. You are my friend.
Words together for this presentation, I realized that it really is not all that surprising that mathematicians are often viewed as, a bit eccentric at best. We are a misunderstood lot, as our brains simply seem to work a bit differently than most. I came to this conclusion as I thought about Ben Siegel speaking to the graduating members of Cornell and their parents a couple weeks ago about numbers and how he finds it irresistible to find ways that any given set of numbers relate to one another through simple arithmetic operations. The disquiet in Ben's audience that evening was palpable. Even Ben sensed that not many people present could relate to the mental, numerical games he plays. I chuckled as I leaned over to John Downey and confessed that I did the same thing. Ben has stood out as an excellent math student throughout his high school years. Qualifying to represent the Academy at the Main State Math Meet all 4 years is no easy task. That means that as a freshman, he was outperforming sophomores, juniors, and seniors on math team competitions. In class, he's always focused and actively involved in the topic of the day. He is confident enough to take the risk to offer solutions to problems posed to the class, and he generously assists classmates who are struggling to understand the new concepts and master the complex skills required to reach accurate solutions. Both last year and this year, he earned the highest scores in AB and BC calculus courses, respectively. At that cum laude event, Ben wrapped up by thanking me for my role as his advisor, his math team coach, and his calculus teacher. This evening, I'd like to thank Ben for his contributions to Berwick, both in math and beyond. Ben, I'm not sure if you were looking for serendipitous or fortuitous in the right adjective to describe Mr. Smith having assigned you to my advisor group, but it has been a privilege to be your advisor, your coach, your teacher, and as of tomorrow, we can even be official Facebook friends.
Thank you. program. This honor is awarded upon the recommendation of the Upper School Music faculty. Ian McFarland is a multi-talented and multifaceted musician. He is highly motivated and enthusiastic in promoting music to other students. His passion for music runs deep. He has performed in concerts, coffee houses, provided live music for dance shows, and works behind the scenes in the booth. He is a composer, and he has shown his prowess in both guitar and traditional theory, challenging himself to independently prepare for the AP theory exam. Ian is at the top of his game in guitar performance and in music technology. Recently, an already accomplished younger guitarist mentioned that his goal was someday to shred like Ian. Ian has an understanding far beyond his years of the big umbrella that encompasses music technology, including composition and production. Ian stands out in music as a student who has an insatiable thirst for knowledge. He, too, is a humble musician. He reaches out to fellow musicians to join in the fun of music making and steps back so others can stand in the light. Selfishly, Ian has been an inspiration to my own teaching. I have rarely come across a student who could almost convince me tritones are legal in part writing, or artfully teach an entire lesson demonstrating and describing how to write dubstep in a way that everybody could understand. In recent days, I have seen much written as to whether the phrase, follow your passion, is really good advice, or if it's just a worn-out adage that has no place in the reality of earning a living or the viability of a profession. Ian is the example as he follows his passion and dream as he heads off to Berwick College of Music. It is my pleasure and honor to present the Baccalaureate Award for Music to Ian McFarland.
Congratulations, Devin, for your excellent performance in physics this year.
Spanish exam, and Katie Davis has quite remarkably
earned a gold medal in each of her 5 attempts. That means that she is placed in the 95th percentile or higher nationally every time and has always ranked 2nd or 3rd in the state of Maine. In just the past 2 years, she has been awarded $450 in cash prizes in recognition of the gold medals that she has brought home to our state chapter. Katie earned the Foreign Language Departmental Recognition Award as a freshman and was inducted into the National Spanish Honor Society as a sophomore. Yet Katie's greatest accomplishment, in my humble opinion, came in her junior year when she went to live and study in Spain for a semester. One of our core values is stretching through engagement, which includes risk-taking and grappling with knowledge. We want our students to go outside of their comfort zone, even at the risk of failure or discomfort. As a teenager, one of the most daunting experiences has to be spending an extended amount of time in another country, taking classes, and living with a family that does not speak your native tongue. Testing yourself in new and often difficult, frustrating ways. To have the courage to abandon her friends, family, and comforts at home, to travel to Spain, and then Peru, speaks to Katie's character, commitment, and courage. A passion for the Spanish language certainly burned in Katie before she left, but it has absolutely overflowed from her since she has returned. It is clear through her attitude and actions that she is not driven by grades, but by her passions and her curiosity. She wants to be challenged so that she can enrich her life and achieve some goals along the way. So for her dedication and, of course, talent, I'm delighted to present this year's Spanish Award to Katie Vegas. Thank you for the energy and high standards that you have brought to the classroom.
She has been a student who has excelled in every art class that she has ever taken, culminating in AP Art this year, where she created an original and formally beautiful portfolio in 3D design. Abby's art demonstrates a keen mind for the structure and architecture of her ideas. It is richly inventive and draws from a deep wellspring of creativity. She is a truly interdisciplinary artist, and her work resonates with her interests in literature, math, and the human experience. There is also something magical about walking into Abby's world. In it, you might encounter dissected science books, as well as star-crossed lovers, fractals, as well as treasure boxes, or disguises and masks, as well as openings and portals to other worlds. Her momentum for making art is still building, as she recently completed a sculpture for an ill patient for her senior project, and is now bound for Penn State in the fall, where she will study architecture. I am proud to present the Baccalaureate Award to Abby Scanlon.
Two years ago, the commencement speaker for my brother's graduating class offered some advice
for anyone to ask to give a speech at this type of event. He said, stick to what you know. So right off the bat, I knew my speech tonight would have to be short. Like many of you, I'm sure, I'm coming in tonight with mixed emotions. I haven't even graduated yet, and I'm feeling homesick and nostalgic for all the great times we've had here at Berwick. I'm going to miss all my classmates, and believe it or not, faculty too, at college next year. Speaking of college tonight, I'm feeling anxious. I'm jumping through the hoops of the housing application and the meal plan and ordering the right sheets. After senior spring, I'm feeling a little worried about what my parents are going to do when they see my report card. Surprise, Mom and Dad! And to be perfectly honest, I'm feeling a little bit nervous just standing here speaking in front of you. But I'm also feeling this great sense of accomplishment and pride for our class and for our school. And over all the other emotions I'm feeling tonight, I'm going to choose happiness. So, and that's kind of what I want to talk about tonight. I'm not going to pretend I have the authority to stand here and be anyone's life coach. I'm not trying to preach my wisdom or enlighten anyone. Just a few weeks ago, I was up here drinking a full glass of maple syrup on stage. So I won't say anything that hasn't been said before. Like author David Foster Wallace said in his commencement address to Kenyon College, the most obvious important realities are often the hardest to see and talk about. So I want to share a lesson I learned here at Berwick about happiness. And I thought, what better way to do that than with starting with failure and vulnerability? But in all honesty, that's where we end. I remember holding my rejection letter from my first choice college and feeling crushed. I think it's safe to say all of us, or at least the majority, dealt with at least one of these letters. I'll admit that it stung for a little, but I put the letter up on the wall of shame with some of my friends, and I was actually surprised at how happy I was to do so. I didn't have that weight hanging over my shoulders anymore. The uncertainty regarding my future really allowed me to live in the present, to embrace the little time left, the little time I had left here at Berwick. I was honestly happy, largely as a result of this awesome group of kids on stage here. If there's one thing Berwick Academy has taught each and every one of us, it's balance. Balance, according to Berwick's core values, means challenging ourselves with ambitious goals while nurturing each other with joy and humor. I don't think I can find a better description of the 4 years I spent, or the 5 years I spent here, excuse me. The fact that we're sitting here in good spirits is a pretty good indication that we've learned to successfully balance our commitments with our personal happiness over the past 4 years. But that can't end here. Our school's mission statement is to promote virtue and useful knowledge. That doesn't necessarily mean finding the derivative or of a function or acing an AP test. For me, it meant understanding that happiness is a priority, and that nothing, no college acceptance letter, no grade, no salary can take its place. And that if you take one thing away from the speech, I hope it's that. I'm not saying certain things aren't worth sacrificing for. I'm just saying happiness deserves to be more than just a lofty goal for the future. This speech isn't about me. It's about us. The tremendous group of strong, brilliant, attractive students that make up the class of the highs and lows of our ideal experience, especially all the times we made each other smile. I said earlier that out of the mix of emotions I'm feeling today, I'm going to choose to be happy. The truth is, day in and day out these past 4 years, I didn't have to